Okay, so let's resume. So we're discussing n equals 1 supersymmetry. And last time, we discussed quite a bit of formalism, applying a little motivation for why supersymmetry is a good thing to have in theory of particle physics, such as this kind of model. The formalism was rather involved in places. So I want to make sure that no one loses the big picture. The big picture is that we have an equal number of bosonic fermionic freedom, and we find that when we have this this behavior, we can address things with the gauge hierarchy problem in this standard model in a relatively nice way. So in the tutorials last time, we worked out that the energies were bigger than or equal to zero when we had supersymmetry. So ground state energy saturates its bound, and E equals zero is the vacuum of our quantum field theory, which enjoys supersymmetry. Now, the vacuum need not be unique. Vacuum on modulized space vacua, and particle we're after is somewhere to characterize what the vacuum geometry ends up looking like. So, in order to get there first, we need to describe how we solve the vacuum of these quantum field theories. So, that's what I'd like to discuss now. So, that's one fact that we encountered. Another fact is that Susi algebra includes the system of this, and because of this, we have different states having the same mass. And we can check this relatively easily, starting with the algebra. Now, supersymmetric ground state, so I'll call the ground state 0. As I said, the vacuum needs to be unique, so there could be as many possible ground states in the system. When the supergenerators act on the ground states, they annihilate the ground state. So this we want to consider situations in which the generators are annihilating the ground state in order to solve with the vacuum of these theories. Okay, so we recall from last time that we had these chiral fields, phi, and we had an expansion which terminated, and the expansion looked something like this. In superspace. And for these chiral fields, if we do Susi transformations, which look like this, potential delta's chiral fields only changes up to the total derivative, if at all. So these Susi transformations preserve the form of the action. So the kinetic terms for these chiral fields in quantum language will look like, so we've got a bunch of these chiral fields, and we have the usual kinetic terms. I'm writing things in terms of bio fermions, dimensions. Okay, so the superpotential is something which you integrate over half of superspace. The superpotential contains terms which we write things in terms of, since the residential is being integrated over the theta squared coordinates, so it's integrated over d theta squared, so we just pick out which terms in the superpotential have a theta squared in them. And those are the terms that survive when you do the integration. So these terms will look like this. Kinetic term and the superpotential term, we can look at the equations of motion for this field F. This field F is called an auxiliary field. The Euler Blanc equation tells us if we differentiate with respect to F, we find that this equals minus dW d phi I from Euler Blanc. This is a fairly trivial equation because we see there are really no F dot terms appear anywhere in the action. So F is called an auxiliary field. We can eliminate F using the equation of motion, and we find the potential will contain some terms which look like Fi squared, which is sum on I dW d phi I from the equation of the measure. So these are called the F terms that appear in the potential. In addition to the F terms, there are so-called D terms that also appear in the potential. The D terms come from the vector superfields. So Lagrangian also contains something which looks like 1 over 2 g squared, A squared plus dA sum on I phi star I TA phi I, where the TAs are generators for the gauge group. And again, the D in the vector superfield is an auxiliary field, and we have an equation of motion which looks like dA is minus g squared sum on I phi I star TA phi I. So these D terms will also contribute to the potential, and the potential ends up looking like sum on I Fi squared plus sum on A dA squared. So there's a F term for each chiral field in our theory, and there's a D term for each generator of the gauge group. So the size of the gauge group determines how many D terms we have. Now, for our vacuum, we want to have a minimum energy state. So in order to find the minimum energy state, we need to set the F terms and the D terms equal to zero. So that's how you solve for the vacuum. You have Fi equals zero for each field I, and dA equals zero for each generator TA. So in general, there's more than one solution to the F-term equations and D-term equations. In fact, there's a moduli space of solutions, a manifold of solutions. And the manifold basically describes the vacuum of our quantum field. Okay, everyone happy with this? So you've seen manifolds of vacuum before. So for example, in Higgs potential, it's maximum half potential, and the minima this Mexican hat lie along a circle. So that's a manifold of possible vacua. Spontaneous symmetry breaking selects one of these vacua from this manifold of possibilities. Okay, so I want to discuss something which is related to manifolds. They were originally called manifoldants. The name was unwieldy, so Thurston and others decided upon the name orbifold instead. So these orbifold theories are examples of n equals 1 theories we encounter, and these orbifold theories have a nice structure. So we want to change topics a bit and discuss these orbifolds, which are which are almost manifolds and interesting enough. So it's a good time to pause and ask if there are any questions before moving to my video talk. Is everyone ecstatic about what we've talked about so far? Okay.
Omega 3 inverse.
omega 3 inverse is the same as omega 3 squared, where omega 3 is equal to 2 pi I over 3.
Okay, so let me define a map, gamma, which sends the points on the torus, z1, z2, and z3, to omega 3, z1, omega 3, z2, and omega 3 to the minus 2, z3. So omega 3 to the minus 2 is the same as omega 3. I'm writing this in this this way in order to make a point later on. So I'm using this z3 in order to find an operation which sends this point to this point.
Okay.
Now I want to identify my point P with gamma. So this defines for me an orbital fold of T6. This orbital fold gives me the space T6 mod Z3.
Okay.
Everyone happy with what I did? So we have a bunch of fixed points under this action. How many fixed points are there? So let's just look at one torus first. The other toruses are just the copies of a single T2. So under this T2, Z1 is identified with omega 3 Z1. What points are there such that this identification leaves Z1 invariant? Well, there's one very obvious one, Z1 equals 0. So where are the less obvious ones?
What does omega 3 mean? Is it any?
Omega 3 is a number. It's e to the 2 pi I over 3. It's a cube root of unit. So remember, points in the torus are identified already in terms of this. So if omega 3 times z1 maps me to z plus an integer, that's the same point. So how many fixed points will we expect for this action? Yes, any integer m translates to the same point. How many fixed points are there? Turns out there are 3 fixed points. So the other fixed points are 1 over root 3, e to the pi I over 6, and 2 over root 3, e to the pi I over 6. So you translate by multiple. So let me just do one of these. So omega 3 times e to the pi I over 6 divided by root 3 works out to be 1 over root 3 e to the 5 pi I over 6, which is the same as 1 over root 3
pi over 6 minus 1, because this is an integer, the same point as e to the pi I over 6. You can work out this guy also maps to where it started. So these are the fixed points of this Z3 action on a single T2. Now we got a T6. How many fixed points are there on T6? So locally, we have a Z3 action sending points to the Z3, identifies points along these axes, and this fixed point sits at the origin, for example, here. So what we have is we have a cone with a fixed point at the origin. Okay, so this is a singular point. So the geometry of the cone is a smooth manifold everywhere except for this point. So because things cease to be nicely differentiable at this point, we have something which is a more general structure than a differential manifold. We have this thing called the overfold. Okay? Now, if we want to consider quantum mechanics or string theory on these orbifold spaces instead of manifold spaces, we need to augment the structure of the theory, and we also need to restrict to certain classes of wave functions. So because, for example, Zi and omega-3 Zi are treated as the same point, we need to have a wave function at these points being the same. So that's one condition. And we get this by taking these states, which live on the original torus, and projecting onto states that are invariant under the action of 1 plus gamma plus gamma squared. So gamma cubed is 1 again, because we have this Z3 action. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that in string theory, we have strings, and we consider the single model on the string roll sheet. And for example, we consider a closed string. We used to require that if we go around the string by 2 pi, the point we map to in the embedding spacetime is the same. Now, that needn't be true in an orbifold. You can map to one of the mirrors that map back to where you were via the orbifold action. So we have the condition that x mu of sigma plus 2 pi and zi of sigma plus 2 pi. So these zi is accounted for 6 coordinates. These x mu's correspond to the other 4 coordinates for a 10-dimensional string. So this has to equal x mu of sigma, because we've gone around the roll sheet, and in dimension 0, 1, 2, 3, we haven't done anything. There's no orbifold. But here, we can return to omega-3 the ki zi sigma. So we have, so ki here is 0, 1, and 2. So E can come back to itself. It can come back to one of its mirror points under the overfold action, because it is identified points. And as a result, we need to include extra states in the string theory. And these are called twisted sector states. so superstring theory is a consistent theory in 10 dimensions. And we can imagine, so we heard in Shinji's lecture that there are these objects called D-brands. And we can put the D-brands at various points. And an orbital of geometry is a special point, or several special points, corresponding to orbital fixed points. Suppose we put D-brands at your full fixed point, then we have a world volume theory. On the D-brand. And these world volume theories are basically informed by the nature of the orbifold action. So we've chosen a discrete group to identify points using, and the choice of the discrete group determines the gauge theory, which lives on the D-brand. These gauge theories, for these orbifold constructions, will be n equals 1 theories, generically, and this is why stuff I'm talking about is related to n equals 1 theories of 4 dimensions. So, in order to preserve n equals 1 supersymmetry in these kind of constructions, so suppose we've got a Zn act. So, Zn, I just have omega n as either the 2 pi I over n. And I think about taking an action gamma, which sends a point z1, z2, z3 to a point omega n to the a, z1, omega n to the b, z2, omega n to the c, z3. I preserve n equals 1 supersymmetry when a plus b plus c equals 0 modulo n. So that's why I wrote this as omega 3, omega 3, omega 3 to the minus 2, in order to emphasize that point. Okay. So by imposing conditions on the kind of orbifold I perform, I'm able to preserve supersymmetry on my world volume theory in 4 dimensions. Okay, so this condition is called the Claviak condition. Now, it's an open question, an interesting open question, to understand how many inequivalent actions I can have that preserve supersymmetry in n equals 1 dimensions. This has sort of been worked out in the abelian groups. It hasn't been worked out more generally, to my knowledge. So if you're looking for a good research problem, there's one. Is everyone happy with orbifolds? Okay, so I want to discuss a way to study the geometric, a way to capture the physics of these quantum field theories in a graphical notation. So that's the next thing we're going to do. Okay, so this graphical notation I'll present was once upon a time called a moose. And then later, the modern word for this is quiver. So I want to consider a particular form of a gauge theory. The gauge theories I'll consider are product groups. So the gauge group G is a product of bunch of GIs, and for simplicity, I'll let all the GI factors be un. So this n here is related to the number of D-brands I put at special points in space-time. And if I have what's called a Sasaki-Einstein space, turns out the cone over Sasaki-Einstein space, so we call Sasaki-Einstein space B, cone over B is Clausius. So Einstein here means the metric, the curvature, the Ricci curvature is proportional to the metric. Sasaki in this context basically means the cone over it is Clausius. So if I put D brands and D3 brands at the tip of the cone, the rule of volume gauge theory on these N D3 brands will be N equals 1. Moreover, in ADS CFT, the dual theory will be ADS 5 cross B. This is Sasaki-Einstein base.
Okay.
So this is a broad class of N equals 1 theories such that the group structure is a product of a bunch of UNs. So now I'm going to come up with some graphical language to describe the matter and the interactions of these N equals 1 theories. So we have in this story a bunch of chiral fields. These chiral fields, so I'm going to call these chiral fields phi, I, j, k. Okay, so the I means that it transforms under the fundamental representation of the gauge group vector gi. The j means it transforms in the anti-fundamental representation of the gauge group vector gj. And the k is multiplicity labeled in case of many of these. Okay? So what I want to do is I want to have a node for each gauge group vector. So there are n nodes corresponding to each of the GIs. Okay? Now I'm going to have arrows to connect these nodes to each other. So suppose this is I and this is J. An arrow starting at I and ending at J in my notation will be a anti-fundamental of the gauge group it's leaving and a fundamental of the gauge group it's entering. So this is a box of J, a box R of I, and a singlet under all these other gauge groups. Okay. So we've got a set of chiral fields. I can denote each chiral field by an arrow in this diagram. Hence the name quiver. It's a collection of arrows. Under the anti-fundamental of this UN transforms the fundamental of this UN and transforms the singlet under this UN. So, 513 transforms to what here? Starts at 1 and ends at 3. So what is this? No. It starts at 1, so my notation is if you start here, then you're an anti-fundamental. So it's an anti-fundamental of 1, a singlet of 2, and a fundamental of 3. So similarly, I have 5, 2, 1, 5, 2, 3 as starting at 2, so they're anti-fundamentals here. This one ends at 1, singlet. This one ends at 3, so it's a fundamental here. Okay. And in addition, you can also write down 5, 3, 1, 5, 3, 2, and 5, 3, 3. So 5, 3, 3 is this arrow here, which starts at 3, ends at 3, the singlet of 1 and 2, and an adjoint. So that's the matter content of this, this theory. This theory is called SPP. SPP stands for suspended pinch point. There's a particular type of singularity that you encounter. And if you put singularity is defined in three complex coordinates, four complex coordinates, as this equation here, you put the D range, the origin of the singularity, and the role of wide gauge theory. These heat rays is described by this matter content. So this is just the matter content so far. I also need to specify the interactions in order to tell you about the quantum field theory. So the interactions are given to us as superpotential. Superpotential for this theory, I'll just write down. Potential is going to be a subset of closed loops in this group diagram. Superpotential is a gauge invariant object. So we have a trace of 5, 3, 2, 5, 2, 1, 5, 1, 2, 5, 3, 1, 5, 1, 3, 5, 3, 1, 5, 1, 2. Okay, so each of these terms is a closed loop in our Krummer diagram. So let's go to the first one here. 5, 3, 3 starts at 3 and ends at 3. 5, 3, 1 goes from 3 to 1. And 5, 1, 3 takes us back to 3. So each term here starts, so this term here starts at 3 and ends at 3. Similarly, all the other terms start at a particular gauge group and ends at the same gauge group. So that's how you construct some gauge invariant quantity, because you're tracing the traces over the gauge indices. So for example, the first term here, trace 5, 3, 3, 5, 3, 1, 5, 1, 3 is 5, 3, 3 with indices AB. This A is a, say, an anti-fundamental index, and this is a fundamental index. And then I have 5, 3, 1. It's an anti-fundamental index and a fundamental index in gauge group U1 now, UN1, and then last term by 1-3 is anti-fundamental of UN1 and a fundamental of UN3. So I sum over p indices, they get into the gauge invariant quantity. Okay, so the superpotentials then are where we get the F-term equations. So by differentiating with respect to each of the chiral fields that appear in superpotential, we have a set of constraint equations. And the solution to these set of equations helps specify the vacuum geometry of the theory. So we know the F-terms you can cancel in order to have the vacuum configuration. Okay? F-terms vanish in the vacuum. Okay, so that's one class of N equals 1 theories that we'll examine. Another class of N equals 1 theories comes directly from considering orbifold theories again. So we consider D brands on ALE spaces. Let's take the ADE groups. These are essentially products of UN theories, products of SO theories, and some exceptional theories. And we consider these are discrete groups, these are discrete subgroups of SU2. And we consider acting with these discrete subgroups of SU2 on coordinates in C6 and in C3 in six-dimensional space. We consider C times C2 mod gamma, where gamma is one of these discrete subgroups of SU2. Then the world volume gauge theories that we obtain from D-brands, the orbifold singularities, these correspond to the affine Dinkin diagrams of the ADE groups. And the affine Dinkin diagrams of these ADE groups are precisely the quivers for this class of theories. The reason this is interesting is that this is a identification of these Dinkin diagrams with quivers. Known as the Mackay correspondence, and what Douglas and Moore showed was that if you look at the vacuum moduli space, the set of vacua of these theories, the set of vacua of these theories give you some geometry. That geometry is precisely the geometric resolution of the singularity. So you have a D-brain world volume theory. On these D-brains, have some supersymmetric theory. The vacuum is geometry. And it's the same geometry you use to resolve the singularity. So the world volume theory on these D-brands knows about the springy resolution of the singularity in directions transverse to the D3 brands. This is very deep. This is saying the vacuum moduli space of these theories tell you about the string construction which you used to get the theories in the first place. So this is one reason why understanding the vacua of N equals 1 theories is interesting. It may teach you something about how to get this particular theory you're studying from string theory. And this is the paradigmatic example. Singularities you associate with black holes, say, have a singular point, the notion of geometry is about making sense. The curvature is all blow up, and one of the fundamental ideas behind Einstein gravity is that geometry is smooth, and you can address physics in space-time using techniques of differential geometry. That stops making sense at a singular point. So the hope in a quantum theory of gravity is that we can address what singularities really are and find some way to make sense of singularities in the quantum theory. So there's been some progress on this in black holes in very, very symmetric settings. But in general, we don't know how to deal with singularities in string theory. One of the singularities we're most interested in understanding is the initial singularity, or Big Bang, which the universe began. We have essentially no clue for how to make sense of this using string theory. These orbital fold singularities, however, they implicate only space. There's no, I'm not orbital folding time anywhere. So, there's a hope that we can make sense of singularities in space in a much easier way than we would make sense of singularities in space-time. And it turns out that's true. So the singularities in space, we can make sense of. We essentially replace a singular point with the sphere, roughly speaking. And the way you make this replacement essentially describes the resolution of the singularity. Now, depending upon the singularity you're resolving, you're essentially blowing up a singular point by replacing it with something else. And that something else depends on what your singularity originally was. So in these cases, we essentially know how to make sense of these singularities. We include the twisted sectors corresponding to the strings which close in the orbital fold but don't close in the covering space. And we project onto wave functions that are invariant from the action of the orbital fold group. And once we include these twisted states, once we geometrically resolve these singularities, we can understand the physics from the perspective of string theory in this context. Now, it's a remarkable fact that for these theories, just by looking at the vacuum structure of field theory, we're learning something about the resolution of the singularity. So the vacuum structure is basically, you know, something in the deep infrared of these field theories. And somehow, this physics in the very, very deep infrared is telling us about how the singular point where these deep brains are sitting is resolved geometrically. So that's it's exciting that there's this technology to understand the physics of these singularities just by studying gauge theory. Does that answer your question?
Again, what this means once we find the vacuum of the theory.
So in order to understand how to parameterize these vacua, one uses some techniques from, elementary algebra, basically. So I'll discuss a little bit about ring theory in order to make sense of this instruction next time.
Okay, other questions?
All right, so I think I'm tomorrow at 11, so I'll see you then.